Hello YouTube. I will continue my description of the paranormal phenomena of Yakutia, and I want to mention today the mysterious landing strips of this faraway Arctic land in Russia. Now we know about the Nazca Desert. It's a high, wide, arid plateau which stretches 37 miles between the towns of Nazca and Palpa in southern Peru. Well, in an isolated valley high in the Andes Mountains of central Peru lies one of the greatest ancient mysteries. There's a gigantic mosaic about 37 miles long and 1 mile wide. It consists of gargantuan stylized figures cut into the rocky desert, drawn into the valley floor. As you know, because most people who are into paranormal phenomena research know about the thousands of lines in various shapes, such as monkey, condor, hummingbird, spider, lizard, and many more among the many drawings and geometric figures, so large that they are visible only from the air. What are they? An ancient astronomical calendar. Some people believe them to be alien landing strips. Some Russian researchers considered them to be products of rituals and special illumination, and someday I'll get into this. We don't know what Nazca lines are. What we do know that they were first discovered in the 1920s, when the commercial aircraft began flying across the Peruvian desert, and the passengers reported seeing primitive landing strips on the ground below. So what does it have to do with the land on the other side of the planet, the frozen Arctic land of Yakutia? Well, you see, it was very interesting that some years ago, Naše Vreme, a newspaper in the city of Yakutsk, published a fascinating article about it. In the summer of 1978, Pavel Serkin, who at the time worked in Yakutia, was flying aboard a Russian An-2 small aircraft. The plane left the Ust-Mansisk airport and flew in the northeasterly direction. About 45 minutes into the flight, he observed the vast spurs of the Jungjur mountain range. There, on an uneven rocky surface, one could see three wide 30 to 40 meters strips. They were located in a very strange fashion. One was long, the other too short. All of them intersect in one place. The point of their intersection is a small mountain lake. A brook flows into this lake. The strips are completely devoid of vegetation and there are no remnants of any trees or shrubs. The central strip ascends the mountain slope from the direction of the lake. It appears as if it runs through the rocks, and then for the next 300 or 400 meters it runs along the crest of the mountain, covering both slopes. Then the strip leaves the crest and disappears in the north. Because the relief is uneven, the end of the strip is not visible from the aircraft flying at an altitude of 800 to 1,000 meters. In 1978, the area had no roads or settlements. The climate is very harsh and the forest is very sparse. Who made the strips? What purpose would they serve in this remote area? And why would anyone build them along such a difficult route? Are there mysterious strips that are part of an abandoned military facility, a secret site, or, as some people think, an alien landing strip? But now I want to talk to you about one of the most mysterious places in Yakutia. And I've been doing research for a number of years and actually talked about it in one of the Ancient Aliens episodes, and I've been collecting more information ever since. But let me start with the basic, so you know, and you will keep an eye on the reports from Yakutia, because surely there'll be more. It's about the so-called Valley of Death. In the northwest of Yakutia, in the area of Upper Veluwe, lies the territory known in antiquity as Uluyu Cherkechach, or valley of death. The Tongass tribes who had dwelt in the sinister, almost inaccessible area full of broken rock fragments, strewn around for hundreds of kilometers for ages, told stories of strange sightings. One, deeply carved in their tribal memory, recalls how their land was swallowed by sudden darkness. A mighty deafening roar shook the area, a powerful hurricane whirled about, and strong blows struck the ground. The lightning lit the sky. When the darkness left, the amazed Tongass saw a giant vertical structure gleaming in sunlight. It could be seen from many days away. The structure emitted unpleasant, sharp sounds. It also diminished in size until it disappeared underground. Those who ventured to the burned-out site never returned. When the land healed and the plants, animals, and nomadic hunters came back to the area, they found a strange dome-like iron house. It had many lateral supports, but no doors or windows on its smooth surface. Nearby, there were other metallic constructions embedded in the ground. At the spot where the vertical structure had been, the Tongass found a giant vertical crater. The legends described it in details and in awe. The crater consisted of three laughing abysses. In the bowels of the crater, located, was an underground land with its own waning sun. Suffocating stench came from the crater, and no tribe ever settled in the area. On occasions, a revolving island came up from the crater. Now, centuries later, the permafrost swallowed the iron house. An opening was found in its dome. A spiral-like descent led to circular galleries, and there were many metallic rooms. The rooms were warm even during the coldest winters, but whoever spent a few days inside soon died from strange sickness. The elders forbid travel to the area. Numerous legends tell of Nyurgun Butur fiery spheres in the area, disc-shaped flying objects, and explosions that caused genetic diseases. The second fiery sphere destroyed the area 600 years later. The sphere had a new name, Kyun Irbia, or Bright Celestial Messenger. The last such explosion, as far as we know, occurred in September of 1380. There was a famous explorer of Velu in the 19th century, Richard Mach, who mentioned some giant cauldrons. One such cauldron was of enormous proportions. The explorer saw its edge protruding through the ground and several trees that grew on it. Contemporary Russian researchers Gutenev and Mikhailovsky interviewed an elderly nomad who visited the Valley of Death and saw a metallic burrow where lying frozen were skinny, black, one-eyed people in iron clothing. In 1933, Mikhail Petrovich Karetsky from Vladivostok, a visitor to the area, was informed by a Yakut guide that 10 years prior to that, the guide discovered several spherical cauldrons, absolutely round-shaped. The objects protruded from the ground, and their height was greater than that of a human. The object looked brand new. Karetsky described the cauldrons, not spherical in shape, that he observed himself in 1933 to 1939, 6 to 9 meters in diameter. They were made from strange metal, and no piece could be broken off. The metallic surface of a cauldron was covered with some unknown layer, similar to emery paper, but the layer could not be cut. 2. The vegetation around the objects was very strange, unlike anything growing nearby. It was strikingly more luxuriant, and the grass was unusually tall, twice the size of a human. Karetsky and five others slept one night inside such a cauldron. 3 months later, one of them lost all his hair. Karetsky developed strange, painful spots on the side of the head that he slept on while inside the cauldron. They were tiny, but no treatment he used could get rid of those spots. The Tongass legends also mention a strange being, a giant, Uot Usumu Tong Duarai, or a criminal alien who bored through the ground and hides inside, and whose fiery tornado destroys all around. The wilderness, or the valley of death, became on one occasion before a site of a Soviet nuclear testing. Something very strange happened there in the 1950s. When a 10 kiloton nuclear device was tested, the explosion registered the readings of 20 to 30 megatons, the explosive force of a million tons of TNT. What caused the increase of the explosive power of 2 to 3,000 times? No one knows. Now, Russian researchers reasoned that the Soviet nuclear testing damaged one of the mysterious underground structures, releasing the energy contained in it. There is another very interesting bit of information of Yakutia, and that has to do with the well-known Russian biologist Flerov, who discovered a bison skull in Yakutia, and it had a perfect round hole in the forehead. But what's most important about the Valley of Death is, through my research, first of all, I found out that in the 1960s, when the Soviets were making a new water reservoir, the cauldrons were basically flooded. Not all, some. And more or less the location is known where they are. And whoever is interested among serious researchers, they know how to contact me. But there is more to that. There was also a story of a huge explosion in the area in 1925. And of course, there were no nuclear testing in that time in the Soviet Union. There is much more about the Valley of Death that needs to be explored, and I've done a very detailed research, and I hope to talk about it more on Ancient Aliens, or maybe to an interested group of scientists who want to go to the area and work, of course, with their Russian scientific colleagues, because it's very important, and I think it's a treasure trove of Russia, Yakutia, and not only because of the natural resources that it possesses. There are a lot of strange things in Yakutia, and I already mentioned to you in my previous videos about the 1979 influx of UFOs into the Arctic Russian areas. Watch my other videos. I think you will be much more interested in Yakutia or the Republic of Sakha. Thank you for your attention. Please subscribe to my channel and share.